Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to another edition of A Coffee and Chaos, and I'm happy tonight to go into the world of martial arts. Sitting with me is martial arts extraordinaire Bill Viola. And Bill, we want to talk about some of the accomplishments that you've managed here at your school and with your team, but first let's get to the crux of the matter here. We're talking about mixed martial arts, which even after all of the publicity and all of the hype that surrounds it with the UFC and what have you, there's still a lot of controversy about it. So what exactly, and you come from a very, very traditional Japanese style Shotokan.
Sure.
So what is the connection? How do you make the bridge between the traditional martial art and the more modern MMA martial art?
Well, I have a pretty unique upbringing. You know, with my father, he was pioneer of mixed martial arts, so I grew up around that aspect as well as the traditional Shotokan, as you mentioned. I mean, the main bridge is all mixed martial arts start with some form of traditional base, you know, martial arts, whether it be wrestling, whether it be you know, Shotokan karate, whether it be Thai boxing. They all come from some pure traditional martial arts that has now morphed into all these mixtures. So, I mean, bridging the gap is just, you have to be really proficient in one art and then diversify. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, people that try to do a little bit of everything at once, they don't really get good at anything. You know, it's that old saying of chasing too many rabbits. You know, you have to get proficient at one art, and that's what we teach Shotokan karate, and then we diversify from there. You know, you get into the ground fighting, you get into the you know, jiu-jitsu and all the other aspects that make you successful in mixed martial arts. But I'm a firm believer in getting proficient in one solid art and then diversifying.
Yeah, that's a good philosophy. There are still a lot of traditional martial artists who, you know, look at the MMA and they, no, that's not, they don't feel that the art should be a sport.
Well, I disagree. I mean, I do believe that sport pushes us to reach our maximum potential. You know, if you look back at, you know, ancient Greeks, you know, mixed martial arts has been around, you know, the concept of it has been around for, you know, really since the beginning, you know, fighting. We've just modernized it to, you know, have an actual, you know, mainstream sport. And I think that, you know, it helps us reach, you know, more levels of expertise because we push.
Sure. Now, you had mentioned in your first response that, you know, with your dad, you the whole thing behind the UFC, which is really popular, you guys actually pioneered that. This was back in the late 70s.
Well, certainly not me. I was a toddler. But, yeah. I was a toddler in the 70s, but I grew up around it. Mm-hmm. And right, my father and Frank Caligiuri, for all intents and purposes, they invented the mainstream sport of mixed martial arts. You know, decade before the UFC, they brought, you know.
It was a little different back then, wasn't it?
Well,
it was like a tough guy?
He originally called the first competition a tough guy competition. Mm-hmm. And but basically it was organized, legalized mixed martial arts. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was the first of its kind in the country. They had great notoriety. They were, you know, spreading across the state, had plans to go nationwide. Mm-hmm. Really was a government shutdown. You know, they passed the first Senate bill banning mixed martial arts in our country's history. It was actually, they started the legal battle in the early 1980, and it was actually passed in 83 by the Senate that it banned mixed martial arts. You know, that's history right here in Pittsburgh. Yeah. A lot of folks across the world don't even know that, you know, MMA was thriving in the 70s and early 80s and just got snuffed, and people just don't realize it. You know, there was no internet, mm-hmm. no pay-per-view back then, so it wasn't as widespread. But we're bringing attention to it now with, you know, great, you know, media outlets like yourself giving it some notice.
And your dad and Frank fought that pretty hard.
They fought it with everything they had.
Wasn't there one kind of famous thing where they said, don't do this, and your dad and Frank went ahead and did it anyway?
My dad and Frank did a lot of that.
Yeah, I'll bet.
They were told by the attorney general, the state police, a lot of people, they weren't allowed to do their events, and they did defy the verbal warnings because they had no legal precedent to stop them. It was all threats. It took them 3 years to actually get, you know, the legal process to get the politicians behind it and actually draft the bill and get it passed. Mm-hmm. You know, Governor Thornburg eventually passed that bill in 83. But for those 3 years, despite all the threats that they took from, you know, the government, they kept pushing, kept doing their events because they knew what they were doing was perfectly legal. It was just a matter of time, though, before, you know, if politics has something in mind, you know, they draft it. And unfortunately, they didn't have the resources to take it to, you know, the highest levels, you know, take it to the Supreme Court or anything like that. So
there's something else that this change has brought about. I mean, I was talking with your dad a little bit off camera, and my God, it's been, you know, three decades since since we were at the point where we were fighting each other and stuff. But, you know, back in those days, when you had a school, that school pretty much kept to itself. It didn't readily make itself available to other people. It was quick to put down other schools. But if you go onto your website, mm-hmm. you'll find that you're promoting all kinds of different events.
Well, my dad's always had that open mindset. You know, you go back to the 60s and 70s, it mm-hmm. was very, I don't want to say, but almost like a lot of those schools were almost cult-like. I mean, it was like you could only do your one. It was very tunnel vision, you know, one style. And it wasn't just that one style. It was like your style was the best. You know, no matter who you were, it was these major egos. And so there wasn't a lot of sharing of knowledge. But my father and Frank were always open-minded. And that's why they, you know, really promoted mixed martial arts, because they believed in it. Mm-hmm. They didn't believe that any one style could, you know, prevail. Like I told you earlier, get proficient in one style, but then you have to diversify. You have to bring in ground fighting. You have to bring in wrestling. You have to bring in all the other aspects. And they knew that from day one. They mm-hmm. realized that that was the answer, and that's what led them to promoting mixed martial arts, is because they believed and trained that way. You know, mm-hmm. it wasn't just theory. I mean, they did it. That's the way they lived. That's the way they trained. And that's the way I grew up, you know, was to master one art and then move on, you know, and it's, you know, keep adding different tools to make you better.
Mm-hmm. Now, you have a Hollywood connection, too, that I want to talk about and break that down into some. Years ago, you decided to pick up from Pittsburgh and head out to the West Coast. What was the impetus behind that?
Well, long story short is I've always wanted to be a follow my dad's footsteps as far as, like, producing events, tournaments, mm-hmm. competitions. So I really thought the best way to bring more flair to Pittsburgh was to understand the Hollywood industry. So I picked up, I moved to Hollywood. I wanted to learn the ins and outs from the ground up. So I got immediately involved. I worked hard. I got my acceptance into SAG and AFTRA. You know, I initially wanted to do stunt work with my martial arts background. Mm-hmm. I thought that'd be a great in. And I started getting casted for all kinds of different, you know, how Hollywood works. You know, you go for one thing, next thing you know, you're in a music video. So
Yeah,
that's kind of the way it worked. But I gained that knowledge. I gained all the experience that I wanted. I saw the behind the scenes, how it worked. And I brought that knowledge from Hollywood back to Pittsburgh because I wanted to start my own production company specifically to promote martial arts.
So the return to Pittsburgh was planned on your account?
It was going to happen eventually, right? I wanted to, you know, gain whatever experience I could, gain whatever, you know, fame, whatever I could out there, and then bring that knowledge back to Pittsburgh to start my own company.
Mm-hmm.
And that was Kumite Classic Entertainment, and that's what produces all of our stuff now.
So what was the one thing that when you were out on the West Coast, the one thing that you garnered, and as soon as you got it, you said, okay, now I'm ready to go back. I've got this thing now.
I don't know if there was one thing, but I realized that... you know, it was something that was achievable. After seeing, you know, when you're living here in Irwin, Pennsylvania, outside of Pittsburgh, and you look at Hollywood, you think that's just not achievable.
Mm-hmm.
But I went there and I worked. I saw with hard work and with some, you know, some street smarts and some, you know, book smarts, you could take, you know, that atmosphere and what they're doing here, and there's no reason you can't do, you know, bring that formula to Pittsburgh and really put together quality events with, you know, with that flair.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's... You know, I think it's the main thing is I believed in myself that I could do that.
You know, back in the days, you had people like Bruce Lee, Chuck Norris, and every time they would come out with a new movie, the enrollment in traditional karate school, would boom. But today you have the millennium generation, sometimes called the net generation, with all the video games and things like that.
Definitely.
Is it affecting the school? Or
it's a different dynamic for sure. I mean, I remember as a kid, you know, when Karate Kid 1 came out,
mm-hmm.
there was a big boom in the early 80s, and everybody wanted to come and learn karate.
Mm-hmm.
They tried to do the remake, you know, recently with Will Smith's son, and I don't think it had quite the same effect, but, you know, what I see now is, when you touched on earlier, mixed martial arts is really the future because it's so mainstream. When we were younger, like, we traditional martial arts was the only avenue. Now people see that mixed martial arts is really... reality fighting, and I think that the popularity of the UFC is probably a bigger boom than the movies these days, because they see reality fighting on TV, and you know, people want to truly defend themselves, you know, and they see that these athletes are world class and they can compete at the highest levels. But you don't have to be a world class competitor; you can just learn, you know, different styles of martial arts to defend yourself. That's really what it's all been about. It's always been about self-defense.
So these kids that are sitting home basically playing the video games and what have you, what's luring them to put down the controller and come
not
up
enough.
With
a, I mean, that's the problem. I mean, I think you'll see that across the country that we definitely have too many couch potatoes. I mean, that's pretty well documented, our problem with childhood obesity and everything else we have in this nation. I do think that, you know, as a karate instructor myself, I mean, it's just grassroots. I mean, we're out there talking to parents, and we go do demonstrations at schools, and, you know, my students themselves are great examples. And I think parents see that, and that's our biggest tool these days is we live by example, and our students are our testimony. So more than any movie or anything else, we try to teach, you know, quality instruction, and hopefully those kids will, you know, be good moral characters and, you know, bring them into it. Because they're really more so than just physically self-defense. You know, martial arts is teaching – the thing that just straight mixed martial arts won't teach you is the respect, the discipline. Right. There's a lot of gyms that just teach fighting, and we're not about that. We'll teach you mixed martial arts, but we also incorporate the traditional values of respect, determination, discipline, some of those things that are left of just a gym atmosphere of just people pounding each other.
Sure, and when, you know, when parents bring their kids down the train really, don't you think that's what the parents are looking for, the discipline aspect?
I think that's first and foremost. You know, the discipline they're going to earn in karate can carry over to school, carry into life. I mean, my father's motto here at the school is, you know, building champions in life. We may have a host of world champions here, which is great on the athletic standpoint, but, I mean, really it's about building champions in life.
And you do have a plethora of champions here. And we're going to talk a little bit more about that when Coffee and Chaos continues with Bill Viola, right after this. Welcome back to Coffee and Chaos, and we're here at the Allegheny Shotokan School out in, this is officially Irwin, right?
Yeah, North Huntington, Irwin.
Irwin here, talking with Bill Viola. And Bill, something happened. I mean, you sponsor a team that just cleaned up, and we're going to talk a little bit about the 12 World Championships, but there was an event that kind of switched things. You were competing, you were winning the awards, you were the superstar, and then...
And then... car accidents. Yeah, just, you know, I fought my whole life with no, you know, thank God, no major injuries, but I was involved in a rear end, you know, bad car accident, had a neck fracture. It took me out of the competition scene for the first time in my career, and I really didn't know how to react to it at first, but I, looking back, it was really a blessing because I changed gears. I wanted to stay involved in martial arts, of course, because it's my life, and I decided to get into, focus more into coaching and promoting. And that led me into founding the first all-star-based karate team here in Pittsburgh, Team Kumite. And, you know, it was, you know, about 1999, so, you know, 15 or so years ago. And it started small, you know, just because I was building the team there. And to what it's grown into today is just something that I know my father and our whole community is proud of because it's the most dominant, successful karate team in the history of the Pittsburgh
region. Now, let's talk a little bit about that because right now the team recently just won the Super Grands World's Games 24, combined with a dozen world titles and had a total of 20 top three finishes. That's mighty impressive, I got to tell you. Let's take a little time here to show you some of the really neat things that the members of the team won. First, we have this wristwatch. I mean, geez, back in the day, we were lucky if we got a you know, $10 trophy or something. And then on top of the wristwatch, look at these great rings they give the competitors that won. And they also have these commemorative fighting gloves that have the name of the game, the date, and all that. And then this is probably one of the neatest things, this embroidered, gold embroidered black belt with the tournament, the title, and you know, that's really, you know, fantastic stuff there. I just this next question, I got to watch how I ask this because you got some of the team members sitting over there. I don't want to. There's competitions that are both individual and team.
Correct.
Okay, so how do you deal with the egos on that team to make sure that everyone's doing the team stuff and then doing the individual stuff as well?
Well, I got to say again, we're very fortunate that our team is truly a team. I mean, we're more like a family. That's the way we've always trained. That's the way our school is. So I carried my school atmosphere into the team. And whether someone wins first place or gets eliminated in the first round, they're all supporting each other, and they're all very energetic and pushing each other to reach their potential. So I'm very proud about that. Mm-hmm. So when it comes to the team events, they all put their egos aside, and they're pulling. It's a victory for that group. Now, there's no individual egos involved with that. Individual, it's one-on-one, it's you against the world. But as a team, my junior girls team, which won the world title this year, that set the whole tone for the World Games for us, because that was the first event of the World Games, and my girls just dominated. They completed an undefeated season. They had not been beat all year long, so we went into the World Games as a favorite. But some of the teams we hadn't faced, we never faced teams from Mexico and Guatemala. You know, we were just undefeated here on the North American soil.
Sure,
but we competed against the very best, and they racked the year end with an undefeated record and brought that world title home, and it snowballed from there. Once we won that title, my kids and my team members just started bringing them home. It was amazing.
And now you've won titles before.
Sure. So
this wasn't the first one, but this is really the first Blitzkrieg.
This is amazing. I mean, yeah. Pittsburgh, in the 24 years that the World Games have been taking place, this is put into perspective, there's only been a handful of world titles, four that I can think of, prior in the past 23 years. We come in and win 12 in 1 year. That just smashes 23 years worth of, we're not talking my team, we're talking the whole Western Pennsylvania region.
Yeah.
You know, goose eggs for many years.
Yeah.
And this team goes in there and brings home 12 world titles. It's unprecedented, and it was by far it put Pittsburgh on the map.
Now, is this just something where, the chemistry was there and the team clicked, or did you do something different to push this
on? I just think it was years of hard work. I mean, really, this was why I started this team to begin with, and it all just came to a pass here. I mean, it was hard work. These kids sacrifice a lot. They're training every weekend. They're training extra hours on their own. They're doing speed and agility classes. They're doing everything to be a premier athlete. And but I do think it's rhythm. I think by winning that first world title off the bat, the team set the tone, and really it kind of took the pressure off some of them. They thought, oh wow, we got a title for the team.
Yep.
And then everyone just fought loose, and we kept winning and winning and winning. It was just incredible.
Nice. Okay, take us through a typical training session for the team.
Well, I'll take our normal Sunday training sessions. They're here early. We get in, we do a quick warm up, some jogging, calisthenics, and then it's turn and burn. It is what it is. There's kids that are throwing up. I mean, it's just you're pushing yourself to where you can't push anymore. That's the way you have to train. You have to push to your maximum level. It's a lot of bag work. It's a lot of cardio. It's a lot of semi and full contact type sparring. You have to get your body in shape. You got to get your mind in shape. And so that's why we push, to get that mind level to know that in that last 10 seconds of a fight, that's where the champions are made. And we went in with that mindset of, someone might out there have better skill than us, but they're not going to be better prepared than us. And I really think that made a difference. These kids went in prepared, and I knew they had the skill. But everyone has skill. When you go to the World Games, everyone's expected to win. You're not flying in from Guatemala to take second place.
Right.
You're fighting in there to be the best. And so we knew we were going up against, because I've been there many times before. And I think we just outworked them. We just work ethic.
We've talked about this stuff long enough. It's time to actually see what we're talking about.
We're about to take a look at some of Team Kumite's training methods. Today we're going to do a little bit of our endurance and cardio training in preparation for the World Games. We do a lot of bag work, emphasis on hand speed, and just building up their cardiovascular endurance for the fights. So you can see them doing a lot of explosive hand and kicking techniques. It all leads into our two type of competitions that we competed at the World Games. One being our continuous contact training, which is basically a hybrid of kickboxing. It's nonstop action. They fight 2-minute rounds, and it's semi and full contact in training. They push very hard with it. The second is point sparring, in which there is a break when any time you hit a designated area with force and with technique. That is more of a type of style that you'll see from MMA fighters like Lyoto Machida, who's also a Shotokan practitioner and studies the same style of martial arts that we do. So that's the way we train our point fighting, is to really have one good, distinctive, strong technique for scoring patterns. So we train for both, and we won world titles in both levels of competition at the MBL World Games.
I'd like to thank the members, some of the members of Team Kumite, who were here today. And Bill, great talking with you.
Oh, pleasure.
It was a real good seeing your dad again out in front of us. We're reliving stories from way back when. The team has this incredible accomplishment. What's next? What's on the horizon?
Well, we never stop, so it's back to hard work, and we're gearing up for Pittsburgh's largest and most prestigious event. We're happy to sponsor it ourselves. It's the Kumite Classic at the Monroeville Convention Center. It happens over Memorial Day weekend, and the best of the best come into Pittsburgh once a year, so we like to defend our turf, of course.
Sure.
We represent the black and gold. That's what uniforms we wear and everything, because we're Pittsburgh, true and true, and we're proud to do that. So the Kumite Classic is our next big major event that we're training for.
I'd like to thank Bill and members of his team and the folks out here at Allegheny Shotokan for putting up with us today. It was a great, great show. Martial arts, I think, has really changed over the years, but this is truly unique when you come out here and see this place. It has the modern facilities. It has the modern approach to the martial arts, but this really looks like the old traditional martial arts schools from back in the day when I was actually in shape. Well, Bill, I want to wish you an awful lot of luck. Same with the members of your team. That's going to wrap up Coffee and Chaos for this edition. Until the next, I'm Fiore. Thanks for watching.